Let's talk about hex grids in QGIS. Hex grids are a way to map density of points that are overlapping in a tight space, such as this one. Hex grids can be nice because they define a bunch of small polygons that cover your area, and they don't necessarily have any direct relationship with any real boundaries in that area, so they won't be city council districts or census tracts, and they all have the same shape and size. So when you talk about the number of points in each one of those, you can actually just talk about the number of points in each of those, and you don't have to account for the density within them so much. The effect that you get is kind of similar to doing a heat map, but remember that the points are binned into these hexagonal areas. That will be a bit more clear once I actually make a hex grid for you, and there are a few ways of doing that. One is through the MMQGIS plugin, which if you watched the geocoding video, we installed it for this. There's a create grid layer, and that could make hex grids for you. I find it a little tricky to change to make the settings exactly what I want to be. But you can definitely try doing it this way. You might like it more than I do. I think it's a bit easier to use the processing plugin. If you don't have processing in your menu bar, you have to go to plugins, manage install plugins, and you'll have to, for some reason this is taking longer than usual, you'll have to search for processing and make sure this box is checked next to it. That should add it to your menu bar, and when you come down to toolbox, it will, that's not what I wanted. When you go down the toolbox, it's going to open this thing on the right, and you need to search for hex grid, HEX. Okay, so this step is just going to create a grid of hexagons that you can then use. I'm going to make this for, yeah, I'll make it for the burrow layer, and I know the burrow layer, it should be in state plane for this area, which is in feet. That's the projection, state plane projections. So 1,000 feet across might be on the small side. Let's try 2,000. And let's pick a place to save it. And I'm going to call mine hex grid. I have a bunch of others, and I'm overwriting one. Going to hit run. Okay. So let's see if we can get this to open up. Yes. Okay. There we go. So it was complaining there. It complained that the projection was not defined. If you look at the layer properties for whichever layer you're basing the hex grid on, you can see the CRS that is defined here. You might need to go in here and make it really explicit. For some reason, mine's in a different format, but I know that it is actually this one, 2263. So if we did this again, it shouldn't have that problem. Okay, so this is our hex grid. I can drag it down under the burrows so that you can see that they match. That there is a hex covering every part of the burrow, of the burrows. It's rectangular though, right? We have these We have hex grids out here in these areas that we really probably aren't interested in for the purposes of our map, if this is what we're mapping. So the way I usually clean this up is by selecting those polygons, the hex polygons, that overload with some boundary. Overlap with some boundary, I should say. So the easy way to do this is to go to Vector and then Research Tools and go to Select by Location. And I'm selecting features in the hex grid that intersect with the burrows. Okay, and I'm going to add that to the canvas. Although that shouldn't matter. So this is likely going to take a few minutes. Depends on how big your hex grid is. If you have really small hexes, then you're going to have a lot more shapes, and it's going to take a lot longer to do. And while it's doing this, let's talk about other approaches to this. You might have been tempted to intersect or clip the hex grid to your boundaries. And you could do those. You could do those both. But I like to keep, and I think you should, I think it's the right thing to do, I like to keep all the hexagons intact so that they are all covering the same areas, even if they are mostly not overlapping one of your boundary polygons. So, okay, we have a selection now. I can turn off the other layers so you can see the selection, and I'm going to save this. Save as. Right click and save as, and I'm going to browse and say hex grid overlap. Call it that. And I'm only saving the selected features. That's why we selected them. And I'm adding it to the map. Okay, so now we have a layer that is just those selected ones, which means we no longer need this hex grid. Gonna remove it. And you can see that it fits the burrow boundaries pretty nicely. And it actually looks kind of neat, like a pixelated version of the city. So I'm gonna get rid of the burrow boundaries too. We don't need those. And now we can look at the graffiti locations in the way they overlap with these polygons. Let's look at the hex grid attribute table. You see, not super useful. Has latitude and longitude in there. That's kind of redundant. I think it's the center. I assume it's the center for each one. What would be more useful is to know the number of points within each of those polygons. And we can do that relatively simply by going to Vector and Analysis Tools and Points in Polygon. So the input polygon vector layer, that's the hex grid. That's where the count is going to go. And it's also the polygon that's going to be used to see how many points there are in the area. And then the point layer is graffiti locations. It's the only one that's here, but you could absolutely use and just duplicate this hex grid if you were making a bunch of hex maps for New York City. There's nothing specific about it at this point to the data. After this, there will be. And I don't really like this all caps kind of gibberish name. I'm just going to call it count and create a new one that is hex grid count and save and add to the canvas. Okay. I'm not sure that's true. Let's see how that works. The QGIS was saying that the projections don't match, and that might be because the projections weren't specified exactly the same, but they should both be in the state plane projection. And while we're talking about projections again, it's worth noting that you want to make sure that you're in a projection that preserves area pretty well for the place you're at. So if you're in the US, probably one of the state planes is going to serve you best. You want to make sure that these hex grids, kind of the whole point of these hex grids is that you have a bunch of polygons that are the same size, so that when you find the total count within each one, you're actually talking about the same, you're talking about relatively the same areas, so you can actually make an accurate density map. If you made a bunch of hexagons but they were actually distorting the shape a bit, if you were doing it in WGS 84 or something, the hexagons are going to be slightly off. Depends on how big of an area you're looking at. For this relatively small area, it would probably work fine, but for the most part, you're going to want to use a state plane. Okay, this is taking a little longer than I expected. It might take you a while too. I'm going to pause while it finishes working. Okay, so you can see now that we have a new layer hex grid count over here, and that should be the one that now contains the count. Let's check it out. Go to the attribute table, and yeah, we see some zeros, we see twos, ones. The top three have 146, and there are a bunch somewhere in between, in the teens. Many, many, many much lower than that. Okay, so the whole reason we're doing this is to finally get to a point where we can do basically a choropleth with these hexes. I'm going to get rid of the overlap one and stick with just the count right now. And going to double click on that and go to style and do this graduated. If that was a little too fast for you, you might want to go back and look at making choropleth and quantitative maps in QGIS. So the column we want to use is count. This color ramp is fine. And let's classify it and hit apply and see what the results are. Okay, we have a mostly white map. A lot of these, obviously these grids, these hexes out here don't show up very well. That makes sense because there are no points out there. Let's turn off the locations and see what we got. Okay, so, maybe not the best representation of our data. I'm gonna say that this 0 to 29 here is the culprit. Let's see if we can get something better with the natural breaks. Yeah, that looks like it'll be better. That's much better. Okay, so let's look at the graffiti locations again. You see how it's still kind of, it still is missing a bunch of these because there are some hexes with exactly one location in there. That might be okay, depending on the type of map you're making. I think you probably want something with a little bit more contrast when you have so many white like this. And you might also want to somehow signify the zeros. I wouldn't get rid of the zeros, but I might tone those down a little bit in some way. Let's see if pretty breaks isn't, ooh, that is not going to be good at all. Quantile in this case might actually be a good one. Ooh, that kind of overemphasizes most of them, I would say, and that's because for some reason it's picking, there are a lot of zeros, I guess, so they're taking up two classes. That's not terribly helpful in this case. I don't think deleting one is going to help. No. So it's kind of jumping a little bit, which is breaking things. So I think quantile is actually the closest, but we want to change this one to 0 to 1. And get rid of this one. Maybe. Let's delete that one. See what we get. So that's a little bit better. The ones get are faded out a little bit. This one is kind of gigantic now, so we might want to tweak this value too. I don't want to get too far down that road of tweaking these classes, but you can see how picking your classes is really going to affect how your hex grid comes out. And otherwise, I feel like these hexes can be a nice way of looking at your data depending on how dense it is and how important it is to you to be able to say exactly how many of each of these of the graffiti locations or whatever point you're looking at are in each of the areas. With this one in particular, we'll have to change this to one. So in this one, we can say with certainty that hexes with this color have no points in them, whereas hexes in this one have one, and so on. So you can't always say that with, say, a choropleth map where you calculated the density or other things like that. So the hex bins kind of get around that. Okay, so definitely for this one, I might experiment with a smaller hex size. So I might go into the hex grid from layer bounds, make the size even greater than, or even smaller than it was. I believe it was 2000 before. Maybe make it 1000, cut it in half, and see how that affects the patterns that you see in your data. But I'm not going to do that right now because that takes a while to run, and you should be able to do that by following the directions that I just showed you. So that's making a hex map. I hope it was useful for you, and have fun mapping.